السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا، وانفعنا بما علمتنا، وزدنا علما، وألحقنا بعبادك الصالحين. رب اشرح لي صدري، ويسر لي أمري، واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. لستم يا شيخ وطوز صدرك. موتا، yes, we finished موتا. بني هوازن.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. So we finished بني هوازن already, and سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم took the غنيمة in another place. Yes. And I mentioned last time that Malik ibn Auf, the king of بني هوازن, that guy who is 24 years old, he escaped to some castle. And he sit he and some of his soldiers far away from other people. So now Bani Hawazin, the rest of the army, they went to At-Taif. And At-Taif is Bani Saqif, the main tribe Bani Saqif. Yes, At-Taif. So they went there and they have many castles and it was very strong. So now Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he like collect his army again and everything became fine, he want to go to At-Taif to finish that mas'ala. He want to finish at all, like must finish, must stop that kind of war. So he took the army to At-Taif. Why? Because Sayyidina Muhammad, as I mentioned, he was in Mecca after Fatih Mecca. So he's very near from Taif. Mecca and Taif is very near. So he went to At-Taif. In the front of the army, Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid radiallahu anhu was the like leader of the front of the army. Then he started to like surround At-Taif and their castles by the Muslim army. But when I was even reading about that battle, it was one of the most tough battles Muslims had like faced. Why? The castles are very, very strong, and it's not easy just to penetrate like this. Even tough more than Khyber itself. Very tough. Subhanallah. So Muslims try to first to speak with them, not because like our risala, our message is Islam, not war or what kind of thinking the people have. Islam. Even if they are enemies, you have to speak with them about Islam first, not speak about war or anything like that. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent one messenger to them. This is usul al-Islam. Speak with them if they accept Islam or jizya or war. The third option, not the first. Third option is war, not the first option. So he sent one person, one sahabi, to those people in At-Taif. He asked him for aman. Can you give me like aman? You will not kill me if I come. Can I come? Can I speak? Say yes. Go. He entered when they give him like peace, it's okay, you can go. When he just enters, he hits him by the arrow and killed him. Like that. Of course, when you kill a messenger, it's not a prophet. Messenger is like a normal person, like nowadays, ambassador. It's not acceptable in any religion or any law or anything. It's something unacceptable. No matter what kind of religion the people have or what kind of role they have, it's international thing. And everyone knows about it. You can't, you are not allowed to kill any messenger. You are not allowed to kill the ambassador. It's unacceptable. So they killed him. Killing the ambassador or killing the messenger means declaring war. It's clear. The person who killed that Sahabi, he wanted to go out the castle and check the army of Muslims. How many, what they are doing, and all of these things. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he got huge army in that battle actually. Huge army. So that person wanted to go out, he wanted to go out, and he has his horse. So he checked by his horse, why? If someone or the army come towards to him, he can run away again and go to his castle again. the brother of that Sahabi who has been killed, the brother of the messenger, he knew who killed his brother and he saw him from very far away. He was hiding himself until he became behind him. When that person saw him, he ran by his like horse in front. But front way means towards, like means you are going towards to the Muslim army, not his castle. Because the Muslim behind, so you have to move like this to escape from him. Then the Muslim army captured him. And Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw that person. The brother of the messenger told Sayyidina Muhammad, Ya Rasulallah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that person, he is the person who killed our messenger. He killed my brother. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him permission to finish him. Because it's like killing messenger is not acceptable at any religion or any rule or anything. It's like something unacceptable. It's impossible. So they finished him. Then the army moved towards to the castle, Muslim army. Their archer were very, very strong. If you can remember, same what happened in Khaybar. In Khaybar also, when the Muslim army went towards to the castle, they hit them too much, they couldn't do anything. Same happened. They hit them by arrow, so Muslims couldn't move forward, so they go back. Again, another day, try, impossible, no way. Then, Uyayn ibn Hisn, that person who is the master of Bani Ghalafan, which I mentioned him before. And he became Muslim just for ghanima and money and these things. So Islam not inside his heart much, like, you know, giri-giri. So he said, Ya Rasulallah, let me go and speak with them. He said, they will kill you. He said, no, I'm the master of Bani Ghalafan. They can't, if they kill me, 10,000 person from my... my tribe, they will finish them. They are not crazy to do that. He said, okay, go. Uyayn ibn Hisn went to the, like, at Taif, to the castle. He asked them for a man. Say, okay, dozo, come. He enters the castle. They didn't touch him. He said, yes, he is a master. He is not an easy person. He sat with them. And subhanAllah, he's supposed to like make them like give up or make them afraid from the Muslim army. He did the opposite, intentionally. Khiyana to Allah Rasul. Khiyana. He spoke with them, he said, you know, that the Muslim army, they are very weak. They have no experience. You are much stronger than them. Don't think that because they won in Khaybar, that means they are stronger than you. You are the best. Don't scare. Don't give up. Be strong. Gamanishite kudasai, like in Japanese. When they saw that person who supposed to be like a representative of Muslims, right? Representing Muslims. He speak by that way. They were worried very much, now they became very fine and they have like self-confidence and say, we must keep our fighting. Because they were thinking about giving up. Because they still remember what happened in Khaybar and the power of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam became very like strong and he also controlled Mecca. So it's not easy now to speak with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's not easy to have fight with him. Even he finished Hawazin. So it's not easy like to find like speak even with him or be enemy with him. So they know, they were thinking about giving up. But when Uyayn ibn Hisn spoke with them, they changed their mind and said, no, we have to keep our fighting. Then Uyayn ibn Hisn went back to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked him, Ya Uyayn, what you have done? What you have done? He said, Ya Rasulallah, I was speaking with them, I let them scare from our army. I said, your army won in Khaybar, your army did like this, your army did like this. And they are very scared now. He said, Ya Uyayn, really? Did you speak like that? Say, yes, Ya Rasulallah, you speak like that, yes. Say, Ya Uyayn, you said that we are weak army and we are no experience, no power, and our number are less than them, and our experience less than them, and our power less than them, and we will lose that war and you encourage them to continue fighting us. When Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab heard that, he stood up and took his sword and said, Ya Rasulullah, let me cut his neck. See, دعوا يا عمر لا يقولون إن محمدا يقتل أصحابه. Let him to not give a chance to the other people say about me that I'm killing my companions. Then Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he couldn't believe, like, how comes? He said, يا عمينا أتشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله وتفعل ذلك؟ You make شهادة أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمد رسول الله and you are doing like that? Is there any Muslim on the earth doing like that? He say, I am ضعيف, I am weak, please make استغفار for me, please make the dua for me. That's why I am Hasan. Subhanallah. Then Muslims thought about how to like control that castle. It's very strong. They don't know how to do it. I mentioned before when Muslims were fighting against Khaybar Yahud. Khaybar Yahud had like some heavy weapons. I mentioned before catapult and tower and ram and these things. So now Muslims know how to use these things and how to make it. But unfortunately, the quality is not same. They know Yarikata. They know how to do it, how to make it, but still not the same quality because the Jewish people had that kind of experience long time. And it's a new thing for Muslims. So their experience not enough. Not enough. So they made a tower. Tower is tower by the name, tower. But they have like a tire so it can move. And it can contain some soldiers inside and have a ladder. So when you go like near the wall, you put it, climb, and can open the gate and enter. It's like that. But tower is very strong actually. Why? If it's not strong, they can't even bring it until the wall because the archer will kill them. It's not easy. So the tower are like wrapping by leather of animals. So the archer arrow can't penetrate it. Not only that, they put a water. So even the arrow, which have like fire, can't burn it. It's very strong. And it's very wide, very tall, so it can protect the people inside and behind from the archers. Okay, until now it's okay. 100 Muslims from Sahaba took that tower inside and behind. They want to push to go like near and to reach the wall of the castle. They became very close. And archers are hitting. Like they can't do anything. They can't even fire it. They can't burn it. They can't do anything. And no arrow reach any Muslim. Alhamdulillah. But at Ta'if, Bani Thaqif, they were also very strong, as I mentioned. They are very tough. They have catapults, but like smaller than the main catapult, which is big. The catapult, which in our like modern language now, is cannon. So at that time, catapult is a very big machine. They put very big stone and like hit it. It will like destroy the walls and so many things. So they have some catapults above the towers, their own towers, like defending towers. So, but small. They hit the tower of Muslims by that catapult, by stones, not by ballista, like not by the arrow. They keep hitting until they destroyed the Tower of Muslims. When they destroyed it, the soldiers became naked, like no cover. So they started to hit them by arrow, so Muslims went back to the main army. So no way. Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid became angry, like we can't do anything, how? Then next day he went alone near the castle. And moving, and we quote in Arabic, كان يتبختر, like moving by some way on the horse, like showing his power and the izzah of Muslims. and say Halmin Mubariz, anyone want to fight with me one to one? Come. No answer. Going and back, go back, go back. Anyone want to fight me one to one? No answer. Then Abdu Yalin. Abdu Yalin is the person, if I will just remind you. You remember when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after Am al-Huzn, when he wanted to go to Taif to give da'wah there. Abdi Alil and his two brothers, they were there and they didn't give him a chance to speak and they say, you are a liar and like this. Not only that, they approached the other people, their followers, to like mocking from him and hit him by stones and throw him by stones and say bad words to him. This Abdi Alil. So now the time changes. Now he are going by his army now to them. Abdi Alil told Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid, Ya Khalid, wallahi, لو انتظرت عاما كاملا لن يخرج عليك أحد. He said, if you even wait for 1 year, waiting for someone to come to you one-to-one to fight with you one-to-one, we are not coming to fight you, not you. It's impossible. Coward, coward. These came from Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid. They know who is he. No one have courage to fight against Sayyidina Khalid ibn Walid one-to-one like this. It's impossible. Then 20 days surrounding At-Ta'if without any chance, no chance to penetrate them or do anything against them. Then Al-Wahi came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The conclusion of Wahi from Sayyidina Jibreel alayhi salam, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave order to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he is not allowed to conquer At-Ta'if. He has to go back. Clear order from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For hikmah, everything by hikmah, everything by wisdom from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And after a few minutes, you will understand why. After a few minutes, inshallah, you understand why. So the order came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to withdraw his army and go back. While the order came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, wahi came, revelation came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu was fighting with someone from the castle by words. He insults the Muslim army and say, you can't do anything, you are now 20 days, you are like this, you are like this, you are weak. And Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab radiallahu anhu said, you are like a dub, like small small animal, make some holes in the ground. You are just hiding. Wallahi, we will wait for you 1 year here. We will never move. Then Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu asked Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, what should we do? He said, I have wahi now. I received wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that we have to withdraw and go back. Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu went, he heard Sayyidina Umar al-Khattab fighting with that guy. He said, Ya Umar, stop. We have to leave. Say what? He said, we have to leave. He said, why? He said, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam received wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we are not allowed to conquer At-Ta'if anymore. He said, awakala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Really, he said like that? He said, yes. He said, okay. When the word of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, unquestionable, finish. He said something, finish, khalas. Then now they have to go back to where? To some place they call it Al-Jawrana. Where is the Jawrana? Al-Jawrana is a place which they put their all ghanima. The ghanima which they took it from Hawazin, many Hawazin. I mentioned before it was 40,000 sheep. Sheep, 40,000. 24,000 camels. 8,000 women and children. Can you imagine how? And gold and silver uncountable. Uncountable. So now they have to go back to that place to distribute the ghanima. Even though Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was delaying the time, he hoped that Bani Hawazin become Muslims and they can come to take their own money again and their women and everything. Although it's a ghanima, but that's his intention. He don't want to take anything. So he was waiting for them, no chance. After 20 days from surrounding this castle and he went back to Al-Jawrana and stay, he took 10 days waiting and delaying until he maybe someone come or no answer. no one come. Then he, like Shkata 9, he have to distribute the ghanima, otherwise the Sahaba will ask, where is our haq? He started with the al-mu'allafat kulubun. Those masters, master of the tribes, who became Muslims, converted to Islam recently, he want to make their heart like strong and their iman stronger and love Islam more, because their Islam is shaky. Like Ayyam Mahasin, just in one chance he wanted to betray Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So that kind of people, if you give them money, they will like become more closer to Islam, more than the kufr. That's the like intention of al-malafat kulubun. That's why they are one type of the zakah, like eight types, the people who deserve zakah. They are one of them. Although they don't need money. It's not about they need money. It's about that kind of money makes their heart closer to Islam more, they love Islam, then they become stronger in belief. If they become like that, their followers will convert to Islam. So they are the masters of the tribes, those people. So he start to think about Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan, master of Mecca, like it's not normal person. He's the biggest among all of those people. How much he give him? Alone, Abu Sufyan alone. 100 camel, 100 camel, and we call 100 okiya. Okiya means like nowadays it's not our like currency, so we don't use it. So I like it's really uncountable amount of money from gold and silver. 100. He give it to Abu Sufyan. So 100 camel and okiya for 100 okiya from Mazhar, from gold and silver. Enough? No. He said, Ya Rasulullah, Walibni Muawiyah, my son Muawiyah. He said, and your son Muawiyah, 100 camel, 100 okia from gold. Okay. Ya Rasulullah, Walibni Yazid. Not the Yazid, someone else from his kids also. Maybe Yazid or something like that. Yeah. He said, also 100 camel, 100 okia from gold. Sahaba looking just for only like one family, all this money. 100 camel actually is the ransom for Muslim life. Like for someone, if you kill someone by mistake, 100 camel is the ransom. It's very, very crazy amount of money. It's not small money. Even until now, 100 camel is actually wealth. At their time, it was, mashallah, very big amount of money, it's big wealth, 100 camel. Then Abu Sufyan took his money. He couldn't even like hold it. 300 okia from gold is can amount. You can like, can you imagine how much? And 300 camel for him and his two sons. It's crazy money. Then Uyayna ibn Hasm, 100, 100, 100, same. Al-Aqra ibn al-Haris, 100, 100, 100. So they call them Ashab al-Mi'in. Ashab al-Mi'in means those who took 100. Some people, the masters took 100, 100, 100, 100 camel, 100, like, you know, like, okay, you can put some gold dinar inside, it's just one. So you can, it's 100. Can imagine how much money it is. So they took much money and they left. Alaykum salam. Then again, some person from Arab. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam gave him sheep between like wadi min al ghanam means like between two mountains. All the sheep between two mountains, he gave it to him, one person. Say, Rasulullah, for me? Say, yes. He didn't believe. Then he started to lead the sheep to his way, and he is expecting that someone will stop him. Maybe it's a joke or something, but no one will stop him. He think, how? Because he's from Arab, he lived in like a desert. He don't know, like he never see such way or such thing, like that kind of akhlaq, that kind of manners. He never believed like that. You never see like that. Then when he took that money, that like uncountable sheep, he went to his tribe. He said, "Ya qawm aslimu, fa'inna Muhammadan yu'ati ata'a man la yakhsha al-faqr." Convert to Islam. He went to his people in his tribe. He said, convert to Islam. That prophet, peace be upon him, he gave by the way that he never worry about himself that he will become poor in even one moment in his life. He just give. He don't care about his own money or his own wealth. He just give. So convert to Islam. All his tribe convert to Islam. So this is that kind of purpose of al-mu'allaghati kulubum. Why we give them money? By this purpose. One person also from Arab came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he catch him like this. And he didn't even say, Ya Rasulullah. He said, Ya Muhammad. Oh Muhammad. Give me. And be justice. Because Quraysh are injustice people. Can you imagine how he speak with Sayyidina Muhammad? You can imagine speaking with who? And by what kind of way? Yes. That thing happened at the time of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Yes, happened. Not only that, Sahaba radiallahu anhu said that because he caught him by very bad way, it gave a sign, like red line on his neck. Because of that, it was very strong, like catching him like this. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَمَنْ يَعْدِلْ إِلَّمْ أَعْدِلْ. If I will not be justice, then who will be justice? Who? Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab also wanted to kill that person. What are you doing? How you speak with our dear Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like that? But Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, wait, Umar, it's not, wait, I have to deal with him like that. And people started to come and Ya Rasulullah, give me, and he like push him, and he go back, push him and go back until he became, like he touched the tree. Even his clothes started to like be caught by the tree. See, Ya Ibadallah, calm down, I will give you, it's okay. Until he gives them everything. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave everyone except Al-Ansar. Everyone. Even Muhajirin. Because they were very poor and he gave them much. Only Al-Ansar, he didn't give them anything from money. Maybe from Sabaya is okay, like women and this is okay, but not from money. Then Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Ubadah radiallahu anhu is the master of Al-Ansar. Because they were two, Sa'd ibn Ubadah and Sa'd ibn Mu'az. Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Mu'az has been died as Shaheed before in the Ghazawat. So now we have Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Ubadah only. So Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Ubadah radiallahu anhu spoke with Ansar. He saw them very sad, and like you know, you can imagine. You are human. We are human. Like you are sitting, everyone are taken, but you are not taking anything. And 100, 100, 100 is you know, but nothing for Ansar. So Ansar became like very sad. So Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Ubadah, because he is the master, he went to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, Ya Rasulullah, Ansar feel like sad. He say, why? He said, Ya Rasulullah, you give Abu Sufyan, you give Al-Aqra ibn al-Habis, you give Uyayna ibn Hisn, you give this and that, and Muhajirin, and all of those people took money, but like Ansar didn't take anything. He said, and what about you, Ya Sa'd? He said, إِنَّمَا أَنَا نَفَرٌ مِنْ قَوْمِي. I'm one of my people. Like he didn't give like that kind of answer. He said, I'm against or supporting, but I'm one of that of tribe. I'm one of those people. I'm their master. So I'm one like them. إِنَّمَا أَنَا نَفَرٌ مِنْ قَوْمِي. He said, okay. Go and gather all Ansar only. Gather them. And when they are ready, call me. And don't include anyone else, just Ansar. No Muhajirin, no Arab, only Ansar. Like strict order. Then Sayyidina Sa'd ibn Ubadah radiallahu anhu called Al-Ansar, he gathered them and then he asked Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم يا رسول الله I gathered them already. He said okay. He went to them. Then he started to speak. What happened with you? He said, Ya Rasulullah, like you gave them, but we don't have anything. We didn't give us anything like that. They are sad. Like he said, conclusion, because it's a very long conversation. So I give you the conclusion. He said, you were Dallin, right? Not Muslims. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made me the reason of your hidayah, right? Say, لِلَّهِ الْمِنَّ لِلَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ الْمِنَّ Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you have like a favor on us, of course. Yes, of course. He said, and you were poor, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you rich because of me. Say yes. And you were enemies, Aus and Khazraj, actually Ansar are two tribes, Aus and Khazraj. They were fighting between each other 40 years. 40 years, every day fighting. 40 years. Why? Because of camel. Camel. The reason of fighting, the reason of war from the beginning, because of one camel. That kind of, you know, mentality. They were that kind of mentality before. You know, subhanAllah, Islam, it changed everyone. Everyone. Those people, Aus and the Khazraj, those great people who convey Islam to us, in the past, before Islam, they were very big enemies. And what is the reason? One camel. You can imagine how crazy it was. Some of the Sahaba, like in the past, before Islam, they were worshipping idols because you know, there is no Islam for them. That kind of mentality. But subhanAllah, Islam changed everyone. So our honor is by Islam, not the opposite. Islam, not us who are honoring Islam. Islam are honoring us. This is the point. Don't think that you are making a favor for Islam. No. Islam are doing for us, not we are doing for Islam. This is the main point for us. So he said, like, I was the reason for that. He said, yes. And we admit that. Then he said, you also can say, and you will be honest, that I came to you while my people kicked me out, and you supported me. And I was weak, and you made me strong. And you supported me by your money, and by your soul, and by everything. So what he have done, he just reminds them by his haq. In same time, he said their haq, both. His haq and their haq. Then he said, أَمَا تَرْضَوْنَا أَنْ يَذْهَبَ كُلُّ وَاحِدٍ مِّنْهُمْ بِجَمَلِهِ وَشَاتِهِ وَذَهَبِهِ وَتَذْهَبُونَ أَنْتُمْ بِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ سَلَّمْ Subhanallah, this word, wallah, is very deep. Like, لُعَاةُ الدُّنْيَا, like, do you accept, or if you choose, to take one camel or sheep or gold like them and go, or you go back to Medina with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is more better for you? When they heard this word, all of them cried too much. All of them, they couldn't afford this word. They became very emotional. They couldn't, like, subhanAllah, actually, it's a very heavy word, actually. And in Arabic, it's more powerful. In English, just translation. But if you know the meaning in Arabic, subhanAllah, it's very strong. Very powerful word. Like, what is the meaning of someone take just money and go? One day, he will spend it and it will finish. But if you have Rasulullah among you, how big it is? How much honor you have? Nowadays, after 1,400 years, we just, our biggest hope, just to see him in our dream, even one time in our life. Just one time. But we couldn't. Many people couldn't see him. But they can live with him. They can hear his voice when he, like, reciting Quran. They can learn from him day by day. They can take from his barakah. His existence itself is barakah. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So we say, Radina Ya Rasulullah, Wallahi Radina, we are satisfied. Just you become with us, You know, the main point which made Muhajirin, Al-Ansar, radiallahu anhu, Al-Ansar, said not only the money. They thought that because he controlled Mecca, he will stay in Mecca. He will not care about them anymore. He will stay with his original people, Quraysh. That was their main point, more than money itself. But when he said, no, I'm coming back with you. I belong to Medina now. You are my people. Then he made dua for them. Allahumma arham al-muhajirin al-ansar. Allahumma arham al-ansar. Allahumma aali man aadahum. He made dua. And all of them were crying too much and they couldn't afford that kind of situation. And later they became like the most happiest among all of the people, even more than the person who took 100 camel and 100 okia from gold. Why? Because he will have Rasulullah SAW himself. How much honor it is, subhanAllah. Then after that thing, after Ghanima finished and everything finished, Bani Hawazin came. They sent some like group to speak with Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam and negotiate with him. Ya Muhammad, oh Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, give us our like money, please be kind with us. Please forgive us, like Gomen Nasai, like this. He said, I was waiting all that time for you, and no one of you came to me. You are coming now after all people took their haq already. The ghanima already distributed. How can I do anything for you? Say, yeah, Muhammad, please, please, like you are a kind person. You are. He said, ask me in front of the people. Because he spoke with him one to one. He said, no, ask me in front of everyone. Now they already took the money, but still like waiting. So he said, ask me in front of all of them. Then they tried to ask Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam again. Ya Muhammad, of course they don't see us all. They say, Ya Muhammad, give us our money, give us our women, our kids, please be kind with us. We are women Nasai, we are sorry, whatever. He said, for money, I can't give anything for you because already people took it and everyone took his haq. I can't bring it back from all of these people. It's impossible. But for your kids or your women, from my side, his haq, like the his share, I give it to you already. Already. I give it to you. Why he insisted, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, to speak in front of everyone, to encourage the other people to do the same as him. To forgive and give. Forgive and give. So when Muhajirin, radiallahu anhum, Sahaba, Muhajirin, they saw our dear Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam doing like that, they understood. Ah, he means like we should release all those like captive people and give them back. Muhajirin said, for our haq, we give it to them, to you, just karamat al Rasulullah. Just for the sake of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For the sake of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Only, not for you. Just for, because our dear Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did like that, we just do like him. When Ansar also saw like that, see, our haq also for you, for the sake of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ailam Nahasm, for my haq, I will never give you anything. Like this. I will never give you anything. The leader of Bani Sulaim, those 1,000 knights, 1,000 cavalry, I will never give you anything. But Bani Sulaim, he is a leader. He said like that. But his people said, all our haq, we give it to you, karamat al Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for sake of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then the leader look at them like this. Khazaltumuni, khazalakum Allah, he made dua again. Why you did like that? See, we are following our dear Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He did like that. We must do like that. Then he couldn't do anything. Then he gives. So Bani Sulaim gives, and we still have who? Ayyam ibn Hazm and Raka'a ibn Hazm. Then now it's only both of them. Give no. Give no. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam ask him. Okay. I am asking you to give those like women and kids to the people. He say no. He say okay. What do you want? You see, I will not give anyone. You see, if I give you something, you will accept. Ariana has asked, how much you will give me? He spoke with who? Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, how much you will give me? He said, okay, for one person, I will give you 4 camels. Is okay? He said, okay. Okay. Then he gives a captive to back. Among those captives in the beginning, before even Bani Huzali came, before the group came, there were 2 people very famous among them. Who, first, there were some women very old, and she said, I am the sister of your prophet, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Say, sister, who? We don't know any sister for him. Then they called Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ya Rasulullah, some woman claims that she is your sister and like this and this. They say, let me see, check, who is she? Then he went to her, say, Ya Rasulullah, do you remember me? Say, who are you? Said, I'm Ash-Shayma, the daughter of Halima al-Sa'diyya, that woman who gives like breastfeeding to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So she is his sister for in Rada'a, breastfeeding. Then he like, how can I confirm that you are my sister? Maybe it's like someone claim. Yes, Shayma is his sister, but how he have like confirm? Maybe anyone can claim that. She said, while you were very young, very small, akashan, while I was holding you on my like zahar, my back, you bit my my back. So the sign is still there. See, if you remember that, then you must be my sister. And he make ikram for her and like generosity and this thing, and she accepted Islam and took shahada, alhamdulillah. And he offered her, if you want to come back with me, because I mean now we are together, you are my sister. He said, now I'm very old and I get used to live with my people, please let me. He said, okay. Second person was very, very famous. Suraka ibn Malik. Suraka is the person, if you remember, when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wanted to travel from Mecca to Medina in Hijra. Suraka was like after them, looking after them. Not looking for them, not looking after them, looking for them. He wanted to kill Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or even capture him, because the price was 100 camel, which I said before, it's very huge wealth. So the person who catch Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, dead or alive, whatever, just catch him, kill him, bring him alive, whatever you will do, just bring him, you will take 100 camel as a reward. So Suraka ibn Malik, of course, is a big fighter in Arab, and he looking for such a huge prize that make him doesn't need any work all his life. 100 camel is enough, more than enough. And you know, like 100 camel, and it will get married to each other and it will increase. So he don't need to work all his life. Finish. He will become wealthy man all his life. So when he was running after Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to catch him, then his horse fell down 3 times and he couldn't do anything. He realized that Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam are protected. Then he understood that. Then he asked Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam for aman. Who asked who? Suraka, the person who have the spear and have sword and have shield and have armor and have horse, asking the other person, other side for peace, although the other side doesn't have any weapon. As you are having gun and the person in front of you doesn't have anything, and you ask him, please don't harm me. How comes? That exactly what happened with Suraka and with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The person who has the weapon, ask the person who doesn't have the weapon, please don't harm me. Then, not only that, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu to write peace for that person. Like he is safe. No one will touch him. Where? While Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was in his weakest time in his life. He give a man for someone who have weapon, have horse, have armor. Can you imagine? When they caught Suraka at that time, after 8 years, he said, I have peace certificate from your prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. See, what kind of peace certificate? Are you joking with us? Say, well, I have it. I can show it to you. Then they say, Ya Rasulallah, someone claims that he has peace and we don't understand what he's speaking about. He said, who is he? Say, Suraka. See, bring the peace certificate. It was written on the bone of camel. Because you know, like at that time, it's not easy or available all the time to have like that, such like paper or it was like, you know, writing above the skin or stone, rock, bone, whatever. So they brought it. It was really, yes, written that he has peace and he's safe. No one will touch him from the followers of Sayyidina Muhammad. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, هذا يوم الوفاء. Now is the day to fulfill our promise. And he released him. Then that's what happened with the people. Bani Hawazin, when they took their women and kids, still didn't accept Islam. Still like, you know, like have that kind of tough heart. The king of Bani Hawazin, his name is Malik ibn Auf. Malik ibn Auf, as I mentioned before in the beginning of that lecture, he was hiding in the castle, in the very far castle. When he was thinking by himself, and when he met the Muslim army before, and thinking deeply, and thinking about the situation around, he said, Wallahi, this region is a tomb. And then Islam penetrated his heart. And he accepted Islam. Then he went to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, "Sayyidina Rasulullah." Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to check if he same as Uwayda ibn Hazm, playing or joking, or he's serious. Then he asked him, "You will lead one unit and you will conquer Taif again, Taif, which he have order, of course, but just to check if that person is loyal or not, his loyalty." He took the unit and he went and attacked Taif. When he attacked Taif, of course he couldn't. Then he went back. He said, okay, stop, it's okay. Now you are fine. He understood that that person is serious. Because he attacked who? He attacked his own people. He accepted Islam. There's no joke. He is serious. He is sincere. That's why he accepted the order of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and did it 100% as he said. This is about Malik ibn Auf. Urwa ibn Mas'ud, the biggest boss in At-Taif. We mentioned him in the time of Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. Sulh al-Hudaybiyah. And his nephew hit his hand when he was speaking with Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I mentioned that before. Urwa ibn Mas'ud, he wasn't in At-Taif. Why? He was in another place in Jordan to learn how to make big catapult and big rams and big towers, because he was thinking to conquer Medina and destroy Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and destroy all Muslims, he and other person. When he came back, he heard about the news and Hawazin has been defeated and Malik ibn Auf became Muslim and Taif was surrounded before. Oh my God, what is going on? Then he asked about Islam more and more. Islam became in his heart. Then he didn't go back to his people. He went to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam directly. At that time, Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam performed one Umrah again, so the second Umrah for him, and went back to Medina. So he went to Medina and he took Shahada in front of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam became very, very happy. Because Urwa ibn Mas'ud is not a normal person. Urwa ibn Mas'ud was mentioned in the Quran, but not by his name. وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَى رَجُلٍ وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَى رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ وَقَالُوا لَوْلَا نُزِّلَ هَذَا الْقُرْآنُ عَلَى رَجُلٍ مِنَ الْقَرْيَتَيْنِ عَظِيمٍ. This is a verse in the Quran. The Mushrikeen said, why this beautiful Quran was revealed to Muhammad? Supposed to be revealed to a huge and high rank person. One of those two persons is Urwa ibn Mas'ud. You can imagine how high rank he was. الوليد بن عتبة, الوليد بن عتبة and عمر بن مسعود. Those two people, how much wisdom they have, how much high rank they have, it has been mentioned in Quran. وقالوا لولا أنزل هذا القرآن على رجل من القريتين عظيم. الطائف, عمر بن مسعود. Other قرية, مكة, الوليد بن عتبة. So he has been mentioned in Quran. That like huge person. So when he became Muslim, سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم became very happy with that person. Then he said, يا رسول الله, let me go to Bani Thaqif, Taif, and give them da'wah. He was very serious. He said, wallahi sa'aktuluk, they will kill you. Don't go. Say, يا رسول الله, please let me go, I want to give da'wah for them, and let's try. See, they will kill you. Inshallah, I'm their master, they will not kill, do anything, it's fine. Say, okay, but they will kill you. Say, Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he knew that that kind of mentality. They didn't accept Islam until that time. Sayyidina Umar ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu went to Al-Taif. Of course, he's a master. When they saw him coming, hugging, how are you, like this. They had some habit that whenever in one of Bani Thaqif traveling outside, when he go back, he must go directly for their god, Al-Lat. He was a female god, Al-Lat. So this like tradition. But when he came back, he just spoke with the people and he went directly to his house. People said, what's wrong with that man? It's his first time in his life. He traveled, come back. No worshiping to our God. Maybe he is tired because of like a long travel. So maybe he's tired. They give him excuse. Then they came to his house and give him food and please and eat. You are our master and you know, very nice words. Then he sat with them, said, Ya Qawm, I invite you to Islam. When he said this word, insulting him, who are you? I'm like this, you are like bad, you are like, starting to insult him by the most like hideous words. But he didn't kill him because he is master. When the time of the prayer came, he climbed his house, he became the top of his house, and he gave azan for the first time in their life to hear azan. Azan? From who? Umar ibn Mas'ud, the master of Bani Thaqif. If people hear that azan and he knows that he's a Muslim, they will become Muslim. So the masters, other masters, took the arrow and finished him, killed him directly. Directly. Even though, after a few days, subhanAllah, their mind changed because Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, while he was surrounding Al-Taif before, and when he went back, some Sahaba asked him, Ya Rasulullah, make dua against him, against Al-Taif. He made dua for them. Ya Allah, please guide them to Islam and bring them to me. Not against them, he made dua to them, for them. So that dua, subhanAllah, has been fulfilled. So after they killed their master, after a few days, they regret their like bad action, and they start to think really about Islam, seriously about Islam. Then they start to make mashwara, the like masters of Al-Taif and Bani Thaqif, and then decided, okay, why not? We can become Muslims, but we have conditions. Look at the conditions. They went as a group to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya Muhammad, Ya Rasulullah, we will accept Islam, but we have conditions. Okay, what is the condition? First, allow us to commit zina. Zina? He said, there is no inner religion with zina. How comes that you have a religion and you are like close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and you are committing zina? How? Say no. See, allow us or we don't become Muslim. Say, don't become Muslim. Okay, Islam is Islam. You accept it all or no? Take it or leave it. Then they went again, speak to each other, mashwara. What should we do? Okay, forget about zina. We still have other conditions. They went back to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ya Rasulullah, okay, no zina, no problem. But we love khamr, we love alcohol. So please let us drink alcohol as we like, and we come Muslim, no problem. He said no. It's not acceptable. See, how is not acceptable. It's haram in our religion. I will not allow any one of you to drink alcohol. If you become Muslim, you will refrain from drinking alcohol. Finish. Again, they went back to speak with each other and what should we do? What should you do? Okay, okay. No alcohol, no zina, but we still have one condition. Let's go back to him. Ya Rasulullah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Okay, no zina, no alcohol. Allow us to deal with riba, interest. He say no. It's prohibited in Islam. I will not allow any one of you to deal with riba. No. Say no khamr, no zina, no alcohol. No, we need. I say no, it's not need, not acceptable. Again, they went back and they make mashwara. Say, what should we do? What should we do? What should we do? Finally, say, okay. Ya Rasulullah, we become Muslim. Okay, we accept. But we still have one condition. Don't destroy our God. Let. Don't destroy our God, please. This thing, we can't accept it. Okay, no khamr, no zina, no riba, no interest. Okay, but don't destroy our God. You say, I will destroy your God. Because it's not God. It's not God. I will destroy it. Again, mashwara. Again, leaving him and speak with each other. What should we do? Finally, finally, after like long time, long conversation, say, okay, we accept Islam. But with one condition, and this one, we can't negotiate with it. What is your condition? If you really insist to destroy our God, Allah, don't ask us to do it. You do it, not us. He said, okay, this is easy. This is easy, okay. It's not a problem. If we destroy you, it's easy. But otherwise, no khamr, no alcohol, like no alcohol, no zina, no interest, right? Say, okay, okay. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sent Sayyidina Amr bin al-As to Bani Saqif to destroy their God, Allah. This is still shaky, you know, like, yes, Islam, but maybe our God is still like correct or fine or real. So we still like have some like confusion. Then they said, okay, let's watch Amr bin al-As. He now coming to destroy our great God, Allah. If he could destroy it, then Islam is correct. If he couldn't and our God killed him, then we will keep our religion and we kick Muhammad and kick everyone. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Sayyidina Amr al-As came and Bismillah, start, dish, finish. Like Allah, their God has been destroyed. They saw it. No chance. Shkatanai. Ashadu Allah ilaha illallah, shana Muhammad Rasulullah. Bani Saqif became Muslims. So that's about Bani Saqif. And now, like in the end of 8 years of Hijrah and going for the beginning of 9th of Hijrah, mashallah, most of the Al-Jazirah Arabia became Muslims, alhamdulillah. Like Saqif, Taif, like this, Hawazin, many people, mashallah, accepted Islam and became as same in Minshan Surah Al-Nasr. إذا جاء نصر الله وفات ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا. Many groups from everywhere coming to take شهادة in front of سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم day by day ما شاء الله. In the 9th of Hijrah, Roman Empire, he realized that now Muslims are totally different. So either if he will stop them forever or he will lose everything. Now there is no joke. Now Muslims in the, like Arabia, like in Jazirah Arabia, become Muslims. Islam spread in the whole area. So he have to put end to that thing or he can't stop them anymore. So he gathered huge army. Huge army. That's why some people misunderstand the Battle of Tabuk. They thought that Sayyidina Muhammad himself wanted to start war with Roman Emperor or Empire. No. It's not like that. The threat came from them. The threat came from them, their side. They gathered army already. And they wanted to conquer Medina already. But as we know that Sayyidina Muhammad, how he deal with them and most of the armies, even Quraysh, he go to them, not wait to, for them to come to Medina. That's his strategy always. So he asked Sahaba to prepare themselves because they are moving to somewhere. And then he said, Tabuk. All the like battles of Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he never mentioned where is he going, except two places only, Khaybar and this one, Tabuk. He said, I'm going to Tabuk. Tabuk means Roman Empire, the biggest like state or army or empire in the world at that time. It's not easy. It was in Shahr Rajab, like month of Rajab or near of that, like in the 9th of Hijrah. So of course there's no fighting, but you can move. Shahr Haram. But you can move, it's okay, you can move. Shahr Rajab, and at that time it was very, very hot. Saif, summer, and very, very hot. And of course, as you know, in summer, the dates grow up, and it becomes a, like the time to take it and sell it and, you know, working the whole year for this moment. So it was very close to takes as summer, like the days and the fruits. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if one of you, everyone who can hold open must come and join the army. It's not optional. Some other like battles, it were optional. Like if you want or not, it's okay. But this one, no. All of you must come. Everyone who can hold open must come. When he said like that, Munafiqeen started to everyone give his excuse. Someone, that person who left the Muslim army in Al-Bay'ah in Sulh Hudaybiyah, when the news, the rumors came that Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan has been killed in Mecca. Then Sayyidina Muhammad took bay'ah from the 1,400 person. I said, except one person didn't give bay'ah. He was hiding behind his red camel because he was munafiq. That person. That munafiq. So that munafiq came to Sayyidina Muhammad. Say, Ya Rasulullah, you know, like all Arab people know that about me. I am the most person who has been affected by women. So. And you know, like Roman women, you know, like yellow hair and blue eyes. So I can't afford myself. I can't control myself. I scare if like I go there, I saw them, I make commit zina. Ya Rasulullah, it's fitna for me. ومنهم ما يقولوا ذلني ولا تفتني. It's mentioned in Surah Al-Tawbah. Allah Subhanahu mentioned that guy, that munafiq in Surah Al-Tawbah, not by his name, but what he said. ومنهم ما يقولوا ذلني ولا تفتني ألا في الفتنة سقطوا وإن جهنم لمحيطكم بالكافرين. الله سبحانه said he is going to hell fire. No play, no game with that. He just give a fake excuse. Then Sahaba رضي الله عنهم started to prepare themselves. But you know, it's very like very hard for them because it's a time to just like pick up like their fruits, dates, after working hard 1 year. But subhanAllah, when Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gives the order, see, samana wa ta'ana. At that time, money was not enough for Muslims, and it was very hot, and time is not even good for them. And they will travel for 1 month. Just travel, moving 1 month, it's not easy for them. So Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was waiting for the people preparing themselves. Some of Muslims, sincere Muslims, but fuqara, poor, came to Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ya Rasulullah, wallah, we don't have any money, but we want to join this army. Please, if you can prepare us by one horse, one camel, weapon, anything, please. He started to give until he didn't find anything to him. He can't like give him anything. So Allah Ta'ala mentioned in Quran, Surah Al-Tawbah, those people have excuse. They are not munafiqeen. They are sincere people, but there is no any ability to prepare them. Then when that number increased and many people doesn't have weapons and horses or food or camels, how to move 1 month. It's 1 month. He, Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in the mosque started to declare for donation, tabarru. Anyone who have like money, please donate for your brothers to like prepare the army. And the army, by the way, it was one of the biggest armies in the time of the life of Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. 30,000 soldiers. In Fath Mecca, 10,000, right? After 1 year, became 30,000. You can imagine how bigger Muslims became. 10,000 in Fath Mecca. In 1 year, after 1 year, plus 20,000, mashallah, became 30,000 soldiers. So how to prepare 30,000 soldiers? It's not easy at that time. I must speak about nowadays. At that time, it was a huge army, 30,000. Muslims started to give donate, even some like miskin have some dates, few dates. He came and gave Rasulullah, this is what I have, please accept it. Munafiqeen watching that, see, what like these deeds will do for that huge army? And God like starting to like joke and insult those people who are giving sadaqah. What kind of to think like that? Those people, that kind of people, just speaking, criticizing, not doing anything. We have them even in our life here. We have. Just speaking, like speaking. Not do anything, not just speaking only. We have that kind of people from the time Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam until today. We have them. Yeah. So that's like akhlaq al-munafiqin. Only speaking, criticizing, but they are sitting like this. Not doing anything. Not giving sadaqah, not encouraging people to do sadaqah, not allowing anyone to do sadaqah. Just like not giving sadaqah and even insulting the people who give sadaqah. SubhanAllah, what kind of akhlaq it is? Then Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu was sitting and Sahaba sitting. Then Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Man yujahiz al-jaysh wa lahu al-jannah." Who prepares that army and his reward will be Jannah, paradise, directly. It's a big chance. But who have money? The point is not like who have money to prepare that army. Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu said, "Ya Rasulullah, alayya, I will prepare 100 camel and everything like the weapon and everything like 100 camel will be prepared for Sabilillah. 100. Sayyidina Hassan became very happy, but of course 100 camel is not enough for, you know, we're speaking about 30,000 soldiers. Again, man yujahizu hadha al-jaysh wa lahu al-jannah. Who can prepare that army and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward him by Jannah. Sayyidina Hassan ibn Affan radiallahu anhu stand up again and say, "Ya Rasulullah, me, I will prepare another 100 camel and everything related to food, weapon, everything." Some narration said he stand up 10 times, which means 1,000 camel. Most of his money already spent. Sayyidina Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he saw that, he said, "Wallahi ma darra Uthman ma fa'ala ba'da al-yawm." Whatever he will do after this day, he is already forgiven. He took guarantee, Jannah, finish. For guarantee, took Jannah for guarantee. Can you imagine that? For guarantee, alhamdulillah. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu and Sayyidina Abu Bakr, always in competition, in ta'a, in worshipping, always in competition. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu always saying like, "I never like became better than Abu Bakr, even one time." This time he said, "Okay, this is my, today is my day. I have to do something. It's not for showing. It's just like he wants really to do something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala." Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu always doesn't have money, but at that time he got a lot of money because, you know, like that Ghazwa and Bani Hawazin, he said, "Mashallah, I have money." He said, "Today is my day." So he came and brought half of his wealth. Half. And he said, "Allah, this is half of my wealth. Fi sabilillah." And he was happy and he thought that there was no one like did anything more, and mashallah, very happy and fi sabilillah. Not for showing, fi sabilillah. then he Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu came and give the money. Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam knew how much money Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu have. So he understood that it's all his money, all his wealth. He said, Ya Abu Bakr, ماذا تركت لعائلتك? What you have left for your family? He said, تركت لهم الله ورسوله. I left for them, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and his messenger. When Sayyidina Umar saw that situation, he said, I give up. I will never be in a competition anymore with Abu Bakr. It's impossible to pass that person. It's impossible. That's why Sayyidina Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم said in hadith, لو وضع إيمان أبي بكر في كفة وإيمان الأمة في كفة لرجح إيمان أبي بكر. If we have skill, real skill, and we put the iman of Abu Bakr in one side, and the whole ummah in the other side, the side of Abu Bakr will win. You can imagine. I'm speaking about who? And at the time of who? Sayyidina Abu Bakr, okay, but about at the time of who? Of Sayyidina Umar, Sayyidina Uthman, Sayyidina Ali, Sayyidina Talha, Sayyidina Zubair. Al-Mubashirin bil Jannah, the 10 people who already took Bishara from Sayyidina Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that they will be in paradise. And Sahaba, the best creation after the prophets. But no, Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, his face alone, more stronger than all of them. You can imagine how great he was. Even though, سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم said about سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه لو كان نبيا بعدي لكان عمر. If there is a prophet after me, he will be عمر. Even several times he see something and the Allah سبحانه وتعالى revealed Quran by same thing. سيدنا عمر بن الخطاب. That's why when we speak about سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, say سيدنا محمد وصاحبيه. صاحبيه means سيدنا أبو بكر and سيدنا عمر. There is no anyone in this ummah are better than Sayyidina Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu and Sayyidina Umar. The highest rank among the whole Ummah. What happened in that battle of Tabuk, inshallah? We will continue, inshallah, if we have Umar next Sunday, inshallah. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk, wa sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa barik ala Sayyidina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.